How do you do, ladies and gentlemen? On our desert island this week is one of Britain's most popular film actors, Dirk Bogarde. Dirk, do you think you could endure the isolation of being on a desert island?
Quite frankly, no. I couldn't. I think I'd go absolutely stark, staring bonkers. I should loathe it.
Apart from the loneliness, is there anything you would find particularly frightening?
Well, the whole thing would frighten me, frankly. Loneliness is the most important thing, but silence, I think, would be the next thing would frighten me to death. After having worked as I do, and have done for now so many years, with so many people in my profession, acting in the cinema particularly, which is a sort of factory atmosphere, you know, you meet so many people in a day, I'd miss it frankly, and the pressure, and the... I really couldn't bear it, right? There's no two ways of it.
Do you have a religious philosophy that would help?
No, I'm afraid I haven't really. I'm a bit of an atheist, I suppose. I think I'd run out of prayers awfully quickly.
Is music an important thing in your
Yes,
life?
Enormously. Enormously.
Did you have any plan in selecting your 8 records?
No, I had no plan, except you didn't let me have enough. I suppose it's rather a mean island. But I picked these basically, I suppose it was on a band, because in the end there were bits of music or the voices that would remind me of times that I'd had and enjoyed, and would set up chain reactions in my mind of pleasanter times, and also would bring back not only nostalgia, but the voices of friends.
What's the first one you have there?
The first one is piano, which I know very much, and it's called A Consolation in D-flat by Liszt.
Why do you choose it?
Basically because it is the consolation which I should need on an island, and it's good for sunset. And also, it's a piece of music that I once had to play myself in a film.
Consolation in D-flat, played by George Bonnet. Dirk, where were you born?
I was born in Hampstead.
Your name is Dutch, I believe.
Yes, my proper name, Van den Bogaert, is Dutch. It's Dutch derivation.
Was there any precedent in your family for the theatre?
Well, my mama was an actress, and her father was an actor. So I had the virus.
Yes, this was your first ambition.
From the very moment I started to breathe, when they slapped my bottom, I think I cried and started to act.
Is this what you did when you immediately left school?
No, immediately leaving school. That's a very long story. We haven't got time for all that. But I was eventually sent off because I was dreadfully bad at school. And I was sent off to the Chelsea Polytechnic in Manresa Road to study stage decor and painting under Graham Sullivan and Henry Moore and some rather splendid teachers of that kind. I was really no good at school and I wouldn't go into the diplomatic corps. And I wouldn't follow my father into the Times, which he was the art editor. So the only thing to do was to put me into an art school, which I knew was going to be a shortcut to the theatre, and it worked out.
Yes. What was your first job in the theatre?
Well, you really want to know, do you? Mm-hmm. Well, my first job in the theatre was cleaning out the gentleman's lavatory in the Kew Theatre.
Was it there that you first trod the boards?
Mm-hmm. No, not there. It was the first time I professionally got paid for treading the boards. I'd been in various amateur dramatic societies before, and repertories that I did sort of little bit in.
Yes.
But it was the first time I got paid 7 and 6 a week.
Mm-hmm. Jack Lear's Kew Theatre, probably the best theatre workshop London's ever had.
Oh, goodness. It's one of the most awful tragedies of our day today. And I may sound old fogey about this, but that theatre is gone.
Mm-hmm.
It was, when you remember, as you well do, the hundreds of us that started or went through those portals.
Yes. What was your first West End appearance?
My first West End appearance was in 1940, the beginning of 1940, in a play by J.B. Priestley called Cornelius, which was at the Westminster.
Mm.
And I was 18 and terribly conceited. And very funny, because I got very good notices, and it went to my head. And I learnt my first lesson, salutary lesson in the theatre, in a scene with Max Adrian, who was playing in the scene with me. I was really mugging it up most frightfully. And Max picked up a huge ledger, it was an office scene. And without me knowing it, hit me smartly on the head and said, never, never do that in the theatre again, and I never have.
Then you went into review.
Then I went into a review called Aversion. All the theatres had closed down except the Windmill, and everyone remembered we were still on in the Reversion at Wyndham's, mm-hmm. with Edith Evans and Pete Ustinov and a really splendid cast there.
And then?
And then, of course, the war caught me, which it had to in the end, and Pete Ustinov and I joined up together on the same day and marched off to war.
6 years in the army. Did you get involved in any services entertainment?
Well, I was so jolly bad when I got into the army, they didn't know what on earth to do with me, and I sent the signals, which is the worst place for me. And so they said, what can you do, rather desperate? And I said, I'm quite good at doing plays. So for a year, I directed the garrison plays at Catterick,
mm-hmm.
Which was really splendid for me and quite nice for some of the blokes up there. But they couldn't go on forever. They had to make me work properly in the end.
Yes. You were a semi-official war artist, too.
Yes, I was. That was after the D-Day landings. I became a semi-official war artist for the Air Ministry and painted, I suppose, what a great many, right from the landing up to Lunenburg.
Yes. When you came back to London after 6 years, how long did it take you to find your feet again?
Well, I came back intending never to go back to the theatre again because I'd enjoyed being a soldier so much. I did try and stick it out for a year after the war, but it was really impossible. My pips weighed rather heavily on my shoulder and all the little pipsqueaks came up that hadn't been in the war. You know, it was all impossible. So one gave it up and I was going to be a teacher, if you can believe it, at a prep school at Windlesham, teaching the little beasts how to play cricket and paint. But fortunately, I got a small part in a play in London and didn't go to the New Prep School just as well I didn't.
Mm-hmm. Which play was this?
It was a play for children and it ran half an hour and I played Jesus Christ and I can't remember what it was called. I was called The Man in the Street.
Mm-hmm. And then?
And then from that I got a television and played a Rope, which was called. And then from that I went up to an audition and got a very super play with a new young actor who was already just being demobbed called Kenneth Moore. And the play was Michael Clayton Hutton's Parlour Glory, which made Kenny and I, you know, yes, as they call it, stars overnight.
Yes, this play was to have considerable consequence for you, wasn't it?
Yes, it changed the whole course of my existence and life.
And a film contract?
Well, that was something that I didn't expect at all. The film contract came, and I was a bit snooty about films, because actors, you know, stage actors are, and we do it for the money. I'm passionate about it now. But I got a film contract with the Rancor conversion, but it did allow me to go back to the theatre every alternate year for 6 months.
Well, we'll talk about your film career in a minute. Let's have another record. What's your second?
Well, the second record, I would have to have something to do with France on my island because I'm a wild francophone. And Yvon Printemps, I think, sort of in this particular little song, C'est la saison d'amour, sums up for me the essence of France and these urban Paris.
Contract with the Rank organization. Now, the Rank film empire was at its peak then, wasn't it?
At its giddy peak, yes.
What was your first film part?
My first film part was a film that I really tried to forget, and most people have forgotten, I think. It wasn't a very important thing, and I was very bad in it. It was called Esther Waters. It took a long time to make, and I was billed all over Brighton as Burke Go-Kart.
How long were you under contract for
it? I was under contract 15 years.
Yeah, how many films did that involve?
Oh, a lot. I should think about... I've made 41 now, and I think about half of that was in that period of the rank.
Of varying quality.
Of very varying quality.
Well, let's talk about good ones. Which do you remember?
Hunted, I particularly remember, which was directed by Charles Crichton, which was a marvellous film, and a little before its time. And The Blue Lamp, which was an Ealing rank picture, directed by Basil Dearden. And a film I particularly liked, which was not a rank film, but was a film called Appointment in London. Those are the three great favourite ones. And then, of course, Doctor in the House, which was the, you know, the turning point again.
Yes. Did you have any right of veto? Could you refuse a part if you wanted to?
Well, they were jolly good to me because they never made me do anything I didn't want to do particularly, but I had to choose one of three or four scripts that they submitted, which was only fair.
Mm-hmm. Have you ever made any really bad mistakes like that?
Yes, turning really down a part. You only had to say mistakes, right? The one came to my mind. A wonderful script was sent to me by a great friend of mine who'd written the part especially for me, called Alan J. Lerner, who wrote My Fair Lady. And I went to America to discuss it with him. I read it, and I was terrified of it because it meant singing and dancing. And I said no, and I turned it down. And it was called Gigi.
Oh, dear.
And I did A Tale of Two Cities instead.
Well, your rank contract eventually came to an end. Since then, you've been freelance.
I've been shopping, yeah.
You made several films abroad. You went to Hollywood for work.
I went to Hollywood indeed. That was a very strange experience.
This was the life story of Liz.
This was a film called Sam Without Him, which indeed it almost was a film without him. It went on and on and on, and our director died after 3 weeks, and it was a written disastrous picture. And the worst part of it was that I had to play the piano, which I didn't know I had to do until I got to Hollywood.
Do you play the piano?
Not at all, no. Never have ever touched a piano. I've seen it in bars, and I've seen it in course rooms in the drawings, but I've never touched one. And I had 85 minutes of piano music to play, and the most complicated, because Liszt was not at all simple. And the piece I want to play in a moment for you, which I've chosen, is the hardest, because it was a very exciting piece to play. It was the first time I played with an orchestra. I played on Liszt's own piano, or one of his own pianos. And I played so hard, and with 8 months' practice of learning how to play, I actually did play the pieces in the end, but not what you hear, that is played by Georges Bellet. I mimed it, if you understand that. And my fingers literally split at the sides and bled, so it was a rather tricky and difficult piece to play, because it's very fast. Very complicated indeed, and not only was I terrified, but my fingers were covered in blood at the end, and so indeed was the keyboard.
What's the piece?
The piece is the Concerto in E-flat by Liszt, and part also on this recording of the Hungarian Fantasy. Servant, indeed, I did with Joe Lacey, and a recent picture which is coming out in a few weeks, which Lacey and I did again together with Tom Courtney, who won the prize of Venice Voice, we're very proud of. It was a film called King and Country, which is about the First World War, which we made in 18 days for £80,000. So we're jolly smug about that. So far.
And in the middle of these rather serious films, you took time off to make another Doctor.
Oh, yes. The Doctors are enormous fun to make, but you know, you can't go on sort of eating black bread all the time. You must have a little jam here and there. So must the audience.
Yes. You haven't spent all your time in film studios. You have done occasional stage plays.
Oh, yes. I've gone back to the theatre a number of times, particularly with Point of Departure, the Jean-Louis play.
Yes.
And a very bad play of Hugo Betti's called Summertime, which we quite enjoyed, but nobody else did. And I got jaundiced in the middle of that as well. But generally speaking, I'm afraid that the awful truth of it is that I have lost my nerve to the theatre. I suffer very badly from claustrophobia, and it's a stupid thing, and no time to bore you with it. But the moment a curtain goes up on the stage, I'm just waiting to be sick, physically sick, you know. And it's the only thing I can remember, so I've decided to pack that in. It's a great shame, because as you know, it's my first love, I was born into it, and I've cut myself off from it.
What's your next film? What are you working on next?
I'm working at the present on a terribly marvellous film, I think, another change for me, another different sort of part, with Julie Christie and Laurence Harvey. Directed by John Schlesinger, who did Billy Liar, and it's called Darling.
Have you any one great professional ambition that you haven't yet achieved?
No, none at all. I'm always asked, I don't want to play Hamlet or Romeo or anything. All I want to do is to go on acting in the cinema until I'm too old to act.
Let's have record number four now.
Well, record number four is an almost unknown record of Judy Garland, who I'd have to have on my island with me anyway because of the warmth and the fun of her voice. This is a funny little number. I've tried to make her sing it 100 times in her concerts. She won't. It's on an LP called The Letter, which is hardly known, and it's called The Worst Kind of Man.
The worst kind of man, some girls will tell you, is the kind that drinks too much at parties, does boring imitations, wears a lampshade for a hat, and when he gets tired of that, he
Garland, the worst kind of man.
I love that bit about the morning glories. It's my favorite piece in the record.
Number five now.
Number five is a very different lady. I make no excuses for this. It's very hackneyed. I adore it. It's Velia, and it's sung by Schwarzkopf, whom I adore. Velia, particularly because The Merry Widow was brought out to Europe during the war by Cyril Richard and Madge Elliott for EMSA. And practically everywhere I went in that campaign, somewhere in the front, somewhere in the back, somewhere in the orchards, The Merry Widow was playing, and one saw it night after night and after Arnhem and places like that. The Merry Widow was very important to me. I love Schwarzkopf, as I said, love The Merry Widow, so here's a sort of perfect marriage of the two.
Dirk, how would you manage on this island practically? Could you look after yourself?
Well, it depends what you give me. Now, if there's water, is there water?
There's water and vegetation and a reasonable climate.
And I can grow things.
Yes?
And a temperate climate. Oh, well, I'd be fine.
You could live off the land.
Oh, yes, I'm very good at gardening.
Fishing?
Yes, excellent. Don't like killing them, but I'm very good at it, if I had to.
Could you build some kind of craft eventually?
Yes, I should. I should cut things down. You mean, would I be capable of building?
Yes.
Oh, yes, I can nail things together.
You wouldn't have any nails.
Well, then I'd lash things together.
Would you try to escape?
Yes, every 4 minutes.
Good luck. Let's have record number six.
Well, now, this would be a fall piece of music, which I, again, like very much indeed. I wasn't playing it. My father had a huge collection of records when I was a child. I brought up with it particularly, not because of the war associations, but all my life I've always loved Beethoven's list, and so I'd like just to have this part of it anyway, if nothing else.
Opening of Beethoven's Fifth Symphony, Bruno Walter conducting the Columbia Symphony Orchestra. Now you've got two left there.
Isn't this rather mean little pile? I've only got two. Well, number seven, the one that I certainly would take with me. Well, everybody's heard rather too much, so I'm not going to do it now because there's another more exciting thing coming up on number eight. But it would be, without any question, Rex Harrison singing I've Grown Accustomed to Her Face from My Fair Lady, which is the sort of most marvelous backhanded love lyric that I've heard for many years. And also, Rex Harrison is the one actor who's influenced my acting life in the theatre and on the screen more than any other actor or living person. And I would have to have him on my island for that beautiful purity of diction and the splendour and power of the English tongue.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's move on to number eight, if we're not going to hear number seven. What's this going to be?
Well, number eight would be something that you've heard a lot of in this country, but we're going to play, at least I'm going to take with me, the original version of Hello, Dolly. There have been lots of rather indifferent recordings of it. But we've been given permission, which is terribly exciting, I think, today, to play the actual soundtrack from the play. And this is as Carol Channing sang it in Hello, Dolly in the show. And in New York, when I saw it in February, after about 4 or 5 days it opened, at the end of this number, which is called The Waiter's Ballet, you sort of leap from your seat and roar and cheer, and it's quite staggering, and they go through all of it all over again for you, and you can't let her leave the theatre. It's one of the most tremendously exciting moments in the theatre, in the musical theatre, equivalent to really to Oklahoma.
Hello! Thank my lucky star. You're looking great, Stanley. Lose some weight, Stanley. Dolly's overjoyed and overwhelmed and overpowered.
Carol Channing and the New York cast in the title song from Hello, Dolly. Well, there are your 8 records, Dirk, although we only played 7. Now, if you could only take 1 record with you, which would it be?
I've always dreaded this question. It's a terrible one to answer. I think in the end, I'd want to take Hello, Dolly, but I think you know, after about 5 years, I might get off the board of it. I don't think I'd ever get bored of Beethoven, so I'd take him.
Mm-hmm. And 1 luxury you can take with you?
Oh, well, now, I would take John Sargent's conversation piece, that wonderful portrait of the Sitwells. You know, with Dame Edith standing in a scarlet velvet dress.
As a child.
She's 14, I think it is. And it's one of the most haunting conversation pictures I've ever seen. It's also very large, so I could make it into a tent. Okay. Or I could make it into a raft, couldn't I?
And 1 book.
1 book, without any question, I'd certainly take as a copy that I took all through the war with me of Swiss Family Robinson, which I bought for tuppence in Lewes High Street when I was about 15. And it was published in 1879. With all the engravings and everything. And it tells you exactly and precisely how to live on a desert island.
Very handy. And thank you, Dirk Bogart, for letting us hear your choice of desert island discs.
Thank you very much for letting me tell you.
Goodbye, everyone.
¶¶